We ask that you take notice of the emergency exits located at all corners of the hall on both levels. Restrooms are to the back of the hall downstairs. Additional accessible bathrooms are located on the main level of the school building. Please take a moment to silence your electronic devices. For the courtesy of everyone in attendance and on stage, we ask that you remain seated and only enter and exit during applause or a break in the program. Thank you and enjoy the performance.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is John Fetter. I'm the director of the Hochstein Sinfonia Strings and the Hochstein Philharmonia Orchestra, and boy, howdy, is it good to see all of you. I am so happy to be back. Have a big round of applause for having a concert. We were able to have a concert last year, but to have our full orchestra back with HPO and just to be able to have everybody here with us in attendance and to make slow progress after everything that everyone has been through, to make slow progress back towards doing what we can to gather together to celebrate our musical achievements like this. It's a really special thing. So thanks to everybody at Hochstein that has made that happen. Thanks to all of the parents that have made that happen at home. And we're gonna have a lot of fun today. So our first piece played for you by the Hochstein Sinfonia Strings is a piece by Camille Saint-Saëns, a French composer. And Saint-Saëns wrote a lot of music that told a lot of stories. One of his most famous works, The Carnival of the Animals, is just a wonderful piece of music that if you haven't heard lately, listen to it again. It's just a real pleasure. And this piece, Danse Macabre, tells a story as well. We begin with night settling at midnight, and you'll hear the bell toll 12 times. And then there's a moment of calm before the skeletons begin to dance. And then there's this wild, crazy Halloween-type party that goes on for quite some time until, at the very end, the rooster crows, signaling the coming of the dawn, and everybody fades away to rest for the daylight hours. So we hope you enjoy Camille Saint-Saëns' Danse Macabre.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. We're going to make a quick seating change. This is something that I do with all of my orchestras. As a violinist who plays in professional orchestras, sitting at the front of the orchestra is a very different experience than sitting at the back. Sitting in the back is a much more difficult thing, and even the distance of one music stand, or sitting one music stand in, can feel very different. So at this age, at this level in particular, and also with the HPO, we try to move around and give everybody a lot of opportunity to sit in different spots to feel what it feels like to be in those different chairs, so that when they're in their ensembles, with having other experiences, they feel comfortable. They feel comfortable with that. The next piece we're going to play for you is by Herr Mozart, Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. We have two of the sort of classical composers represented on our program today, with Mozart and then the final piece with the HPO by Haydn. And Haydn and Mozart actually were alive during the same time, and actually Haydn lived so long that his life completely encompassed Mozart's life. Haydn and Mozart certainly knew each other, but they hadn't met by the time that Mozart wrote this piece. This piece, his 15th symphony, was written when he was about 15 years old. So 14, 15, 16, right in there. And he wrote a lot of music before he was very old, but a lot of his music showed the edits of his father and the edits of, you know, a concerned parent trying to help his son become the best thing he could be. This last movement is a lot of fun. It has a lot of energy throughout the whole movement. And at the end, you'll feel like it ends over and over and over again. And apparently that was something of a little joke that 15-year-old Mozart was playing on the crowds. They would listen to the piece and they would think it was over, and then they would think it was over. And not that anybody would clap, it wasn't that sort of a false ending. But he just kind of keeps going and adds new material that we haven't heard through the whole movement. So we hope you enjoy the finale. Going on in it. It's very complicated, and it involves a lot of different playing techniques. With the Danse Macabre and the Mozart, we're working on kind of trying to play heavily but beautifully, playing off the string and doing lots of things like listening across the group as we have little motors running, little people playing, groups of eighth notes that we're listening for. But in this piece, it's very, very different. We're doing extended techniques, they call them. We're using tremolo, and we're using glissando, we're going all over the instrument, and we're also adding in some other stuff. So, we hope you enjoy Richard Meyer's Rosin Eating Zombies from Outer Space.
Thank you.
favorite Russian composers. There's a violin concerto that some of the young violinists up here might get to play at some point. That is really a fun piece to play. There's a cello concerto. There's lots of great music written by him. But these pieces actually come from a set of piano pieces that he wrote for children. And Kabalevsky didn't compose a whole lot after 1950 or so. After 1950, he became an advocate for music education for everyone. And he spent a lot of time in his native Russia, in the Soviet Union, trying to get groups of people to agree to these kinds of things. He started music schools. He became a member of the International Society for Music Education, or ISMI, as we call it in the music education world. And he became an honorary president of that organization for many, many years, until his death in the 1980s. So he was much like Kodály, if we think of another music educator who was known for his compositional chops, first and foremost. But Kabalevsky wrote a lot of music for children. He wrote many, many, many books of piano music for children. And some of that music works really well with orchestra, and that's what this arrangement does. These three pieces are, I think, great examples of what Kabalevsky liked to say, which he was quoting Gorky, but he said, what's the difference between music written for adults and written for children? Music for children should be better. So we hope you enjoy this Kabalevsky suite. So we are embarking upon a similar rotation of sections. We do it in the winds as well. Wind orchestral playing is a very different animal than what most of these students have done. When they join an orchestra for the first time, they're playing in keys that they don't use a lot, probably, in their school band programs or their school wind symphony. And they also are playing single voices on single parts a lot of the time. And that's a very different experience than being in a section of seven trumpets or whatever the case may be. So I really commend students for wanting to come out and join us in this orchestral endeavor. But we have a whole lot of fun doing it. So the next piece we're going to play for you is by Charles Gounod, a French composer, another French composer. Both of our, two of our Halloween sort of themed offerings for you today are by French composers. And Charles Gounod is our second composer that worked in the Funeral March of the Marionette. Now, many of you know this piece, or you'll know it the instant you hear it, from the Alfred Hitchcock theme, from the Alfred Hitchcock music. But it actually has a little story to it. So this is literally the Funeral March of a Marionette. And what happens is there's a battle right from the start, which the Marionette loses. And then there's a funeral march held in his honor. But you'll hear as they march along, there's a part where they take a little break and they go to a local inn, they have some food and drink, they enjoy themselves, but they do it sort of subtly because they don't want to overdo it. And then they march again to give the Marionette his final two as they march off at the end of the music. So we hope you enjoy Gounod's Funeral March of the Marionette. For our last piece that we're going to play for you today, we're going to play the last movement of Haydn's Third Symphony. Now that is not something you hear someone say very much. When they say Haydn's Symphony number, they usually say, what? We'll throw out a number. 104, 88, 93, who knows? Something up there, because Haydn wrote 104 numbered symphonies, and then there are several others that we think he wrote as well, bring the total to around 107. Haydn was an amazing figure in classical music. He was a court composer in the old tradition, but he was one of the last ones. And he wrote for the Esterházy court, but during this time period, in the where his third symphony comes from, he was writing for another court. And this music is all Haydn. You can hear Haydn coming through already. But he wrote all of these symphonies because people asked him to. He was compelled to do it as an employee. But he didn't feel it was a hardship. He loved what he did. Later in his life, he got to travel to London. He was very famous there. And people really respected him throughout Europe as one of the fathers of much of what we know as Western classical music. In particular, the symphonic tradition, this symphony tradition, he spent so much time composing it. As I said before, his lifespan completely spanned Mozart's life. Mozart's life was completely within Haydn's. And he was one of the most famous known teachers of Beethoven, so he had influence on Beethoven early on. He was also known as the father of the string quartet, I mean, as if the symphony tradition wasn't enough. So, but even in this early symphony, you hear a lot of his kind of life and his spirit in what he writes. This symphony number 3 was one of the first four-movement symphonies. The four-movement symphony is now sort of what we expect when we hear symphonies. And the four-movement symphony is something that Haydn wasn't the only one to do it at this time, but he was one of the first to implement it in this way. So this last movement that we play, this finale for you, also has the compositional technique of a fugue. So you'll hear two voices right off the bat, one long, ba, 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 and one shorter. Ba, 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 da, da, ba. All right, and those two will be fighting the whole way through the piece, but fighting in a friendly way. So it's really a wonderful piece. But before we play it for you, I just want to say thank you again to all of you for being here, for all of your support for these students on stage, and for those students up there. How about one more foot shuffle and big round of applause for the Sinfonia? And also, I would like just an appreciation for the slightly older than the rest of the students, member of the trumpet section, who is Mr. Osika, our assistant conductor and fabulous musician. Thank you. Whether you're a public school teacher, every conductor who's on stage for these youth ensembles is a public school teacher. So we know what you do and we love what you do. We're in the fight with you and we really enjoy it. So this last piece is a celebration of music and I think a really wonderful celebration of our first concert back with our full orchestra. And we hope you enjoy the finale of Haydn's Symphony.